me 30 minutes to talk. I try to be very pedagogic. And then you have copies of the information you will see in the PowerPoint. First, because if you don't understand my words or any words, you have here the basic biography that I will show in this order, yes?
Okay.
In the same order, but a little more complete. And a second part that I believe is very important in this presentation are some thoughts or quotes from Romero that let us pray, if we want. Pray with them and do some Lectio Divina or some prayer with a group. Yeah, then you have a second, there are three different colors. In one color you have the biography, the line, the lifeline. In a second group, you have a poem that was written by a priest from this area, Michigan. And third, you have some quotes that let us reflect and also pray if we want. Okay? This is the organization of the three pages that you found or were put placed there at the entry. I know that there is a very good film, and 3 years ago I presented Romero in a workshop for 3 days with a film, and I want to recommend and openly talk on that before starting, because and probably you have seen the film here, with Social Justice Committee, yes, with Sister Bridget. The film is Monseñor, The Last Journey of Oscar Romero. But what is interesting is that you can find, if you want to work as a process with a group, in English and in Spanish, a packet of proposals, yeah, that is called Monseñor, The Last Study Guide. It's what I use in Spanish in the diocese when we were organizing a workshop with the community, with the Hispanic community, okay? Then, those are resources that you can use and are free. You can find online in English and in Spanish. And very, very well organized. But it takes a long time. We needed 3 meetings of 3 hours to see the film and discuss and learn and place. Okay. First, where is El Salvador? Yeah? I start with a map because it's just a so small country, very, very little country that you can see in the map in Central America. And actually, I was looking for information, it has 6 million of inhabitants, the country, only that. Okay, now, then imagine. In the 70s, probably you have 5 million. Okay, these are some clips that if I have time I will show, if not, we go with the biography. It's important to say that he was born in 1917 from a very, very humble family. The parents were Santo Romero, Guadalupe de Jesus, and he was born in El Salvador. And in 1919, he was baptized when he was 1 year old. I will be very fast with the biography because I want to emphasize the political and the religious importance. As they could not pay, the parents could not afford education for Romero, then he wanted to become a priest, and he was 14, he went to attended to the seminar, and he was ordained priest when he was 25 in 1942. Recognizing the power of the radio, he started giving the preaching and offering the preaching by radio because many peasant people were not attending to mass, because they were not, they felt they were not welcome. And you can ask, why? Why? Well, we have to say that our societies and this is not in the PowerPoint, but it's an explanation, probably useful explanation, about the importance of social classes. The poor with the poor, you know, middle class with middle class, and don't let the poor come here to the church if we are not poor. There is a very classist organization, yeah?
Yes.
And much more in the 70s. Then probably the peasants could not go to the church, they didn't feel welcome, and this is the main reason that Romero started to reach the people through the radio or by radio, I don't know exactly. Okay. In 1970, he was he became a bishop, auxiliary bishop, and then in 1974, he became the bishop of Santiago de Maria. At this time, he was very conservative. He didn't want to change anything, and this is important, because we can see the transformation of Romero when he discovers and he knows how the reality is for the poor people and the humble people. But in 1974, when he became bishop, he's described as a conservative, not wanting to break from tradition. And he was supporting hierarchy to encourage conformity, not change. He was uncomfortable with social action and with political leaders. He didn't want to touch politics. And it's interesting to see the conversion, the transformation, yeah, in his life. Why? When he was bishop of Santiago de Maria, Romero was horrified when he discovered that children were dying because parents could not pay the medicines. Yeah? He began to use the resources of the diocese to help these families but he knew that charity was not enough. He wrote in his diary that people who are poor should not just receive handouts from the church or the government, but participate in changing their lives for the future. This is the first awareness, yeah? Not just to give, change the society, change the structure. In 1977, Romero became Archbishop of San Salvador, the capital city. And the situation in the country was becoming worse. You know, in Central America, between the 70s and the 80s, there were a lot of civil wars, yeah, that caused a lot of death and disappeared people. Just in Guatemala in the 80s, more than 80,000 people were killed during the civil war. And Rigoberta Menchú is talking about that in the book that she could not write because she didn't know how to write, but he was, you know, telling to a journalist. The military were killing the Salvadorian people, especially those demanding justice, just as teachers, nuns, priests, including Romero's good friend, Father Rutilio Grande. Thousands of people began to go missing, and Romero demanded that the president of El Salvador investigate the killings, but he failed to do so. Father Rutilio Grande was the first priest to be killed. There were national shockwaves, and for Romero Rutilio's death was the divine catalyst. He now began to see the situation from the perspective of the victims. The option for the poor would be the locus from which he could pray and judge the suffering reality of El Salvador, and it was the place where he could do his theology and live a spirituality which recognized Christ, the suffering servant, the pierced one, there amongst the poor campesinos. You see the change, the transformation about awareness. Romero initial disbelief at Rutilio killing became prophetic determination. He suspended all participation in official government ceremonies until the assassins were brought to justice. He opened a diocesan legal aid office to document the killings and disappearances and to give pastoral support to the families and communities affected. Crucially, the following Sunday, he decreed that all churches of the diocese be closed.
Oh my gosh.
And the masses cancelled. And he summoned priests and people to a single mass in front of the cathedral, where he preached to a crowd of about over 100,000 people. As he prayed beside the body of the murdered priest, Rutilio Grande, Father Rutilio Grande, he realized that if he were to follow this through to its final consequences, it would, as he wrote, put me on the road to Calvary. And he assented. He made a fundamental option for the poor, and it took him to his martyrdom. I don't know how to pronounce that.
Martyrdom.
I'm sorry. I like this quotation that says, and probably we can read it together. Yeah?
We must save not the soul, but the heart of him, but the person living in his history.
There was the belief and despair across all the communities on the land, but especially in the poor communities among the simple rural peace people. And he and the dwellers he had loved so dearly, defended so courageously, and for whom in the end he gave his life. He took on the wealth on the wealthy landowners for their exploitation of seasonal workers. He took on the military for their torture, killings, and terrorization of the rural population. This brought down persecution on the church, and six priests and dozens of catechists were killed prior to his own assassination. In the film, you can see very nicely all this process of social movements and political action. In his actions and words, Oscar demanded peace, a peace that could only be found by ensuring people had access to basic needs and their rights upheld. He raised awareness globally about the people in his country who had been killed or disappeared. When he visited the Vatican in 1979, Oscar Romero presented the Pope with seven detailed reports of murder, torture, and kidnapping throughout El Salvador. In 1979, the number of people being killed rose to more than 3,000 per month. Oscar Romero had nothing left to offer his people except faith and hope. He continued to use the radio broadcast of his Sunday sermons to tell people what was happening throughout the country and to talk about the role of the church and to offer his listeners hope that they would not suffer and die in vain. In 1980, after reporting the death and disappearances of the week, Oscar Romero began to speak directly to soldiers and policemen, and he said, "I beg you, I implore you, I order you, in the name of God, stop the repression." The following evening, while saying Mass in the chapel of Divine Providence Hospital, Archbishop Oscar Romero was shot by a paid assassin. A marksman's bullet killed him in the middle of the Mass on March 24, 1980. No one was ever prosecuted. They could not find the assassins. Yeah? Only moments before his death, Romero spoke these prophetic words, quote, "Those who surrender to the service of the poor through love of Christ will live like the grain of wheat that dies, The harvest comes because of the grain that dies. Like many great leaders who have fought for truth, Oscar Romero was killed and became a martyr, but his voice could not be silenced. He's a symbol of hope in a country that has suffered poverty, injustice, and violence. And I should say not only the country. Yeah, the influence of this death is all over the Catholic world. Yeah, everybody knows why Romero died. Following his assassination, the war became unstoppable, and during 12 years, claimed over 70,000 lives. You know, in such a small country, so many people were killed. Romero is increasingly recognized as a model Christian, a pastor and a bishop, a saint for the 21st century. In his ministry in San Salvador, he enfleshed or made incarnate the option for the poor. He's a tremendous inspiration to the Live Simply movement. He strengthens our faith, fill us with hope, and make us proud to be justice-seeking Christian pilgrims. Today, Romero stands tall as a truly credible witness to the resurrection of Jesus Christ for these skeptical times. During three dramatic years, Romero became visible to the wider world through his legendary preaching to a nation engulfed in explosive tensions and violence. In a country racked with human rights abuses, enveloped in lies, and covered up and edging every day closer to civil war, Romero fearlessly spoke the truth. He listened to the poor tell their stories. I have something to read together, then you don't fall boring, yeah, about my reading.
Freedom and hope. Let my blood be a seed of freedom and the sign that hope will soon be reality.
He replied once, I offer you this by way of example. A building is on fire, and you are watching it burn, standing and wondering if everyone is safe. Then someone tells you that your mother and your sister are inside that building. Your attitude changes completely. You are frantic. Your mother and sister are burning, and you do anything to rescue them, even at the cost of getting charged. That's what it means to be truly committed. If we look at poverty from the outside, as if we are looking at a fire, that's not to opt for the poor, no matter how concerned we may be. We should get inside as if our mother and sister were burning.
That's right.
Indeed, it's Christ who is there, hungry and suffering. This is a quote from him. Romero's weekly homilies were occasions to interweave catechesis and communication of the social reality. He carefully unpacked the readings and interpreted them in the context of El Salvador. Then came the good news of the week, the meetings in the communities, the celebrations and patronal feasts, the visitors, and letters of solidarity. Then the bad news, incident by incident, atrocity by atrocity, he named the victims. He said what had happened, where and when, and indicated those responsible. He sought justice, supported recompense, and offered pastoral care. This methodology was the forerunner of truth commissions that later emerged around the world. His sermons could last over an hour, but were heard with rapt attention, the only interruption to the flow being applause. Parallels have been been drawn between Romero's 3 years as archbishop and the 3 years of the public life of Jesus. I find this very interesting, because the preaching, the teaching, the praying, and the solitude, the closeness to the poor, the tender love of the vulnerable and destitute, the courage and resolution, the insults hurled, the Pharisee plotting against him, the doubts and the fears, the death threats and the public execution. We could see like a line, a parallel line with the life of Jesus. Romero constantly referred to the three idolatries of the time. And I find that this is very, you know, now we could apply these idolatries. Yeah? Things have not changed too much. Idolatry of wealth and land. Idolatry of power and national security. And on the left, the idolatry of the party organization. They were false gods that demanded human victims. But Romero always used the moment for a call to repent, an invitation to a change of heart. And he said, "Brothers and sisters, keep this treasure. It is not my poor words that so open faith. I am no more than the humble echo of God in his people." I like that. His messages were no to the killing of the right, no to the violence of the left, yes to political organization, yes to dialogue, social justice for the poor, human rights for all Salvadorans, yes to the practice of compassion. And then we can read together this quote, the gospel.
A church that doesn't provoke any crisis, a gospel that doesn't unsettle a word of God, that doesn't get under anyone's skin, a word of God that doesn't touch the real sin of the society in which it is being proclaimed, what gospel is that?
Well, they said on the parallel, you know how is the social, the same is happening now. When I prepared this presentation, I was attending to the march for the migrant people here, and I said, it's the same, you know. In El Salvador, we had the victims were the peasants, and here the victims are the immigrants, yeah? Because when I talk with the families in church, oh, you know, that is not anymore. Now he's in prison. You know that? He, she, them. It's happening daily. It's not imagination. Yeah? Then I can find, they said he was naive and Marxist manipulated. As war came closer, the threats and insults increased. Fake newspapers appear with outrageous headlines attempting to link Romero with terrorists. Oh, that is the easy way, yeah, of the system. A suitcase of dynamite placed behind the altar for his Sunday mass failed to go off. Mm-hmm. Well, that is the media, the power of the media. Romero spoke about his death, and those around him tried to persuade him to have protection or a bodyguard. His response was simple. Why should the shepherd have protection when his sheep are still prey to wolves? The threats became so intense, a fever existed. Romero knew he was going to die. He accepted it with great equanimity. He prepared himself and went like a lamb to the slaughter. From a Christian point of view, remembering means something active. The fundamental Christian model is, do this in memory of me. For the church to remember, lest continue his work and imitate that option for the poor which he embraced and his life and ministry epitomized. And like him, to struggle with the paradoxes and conflicts that such commitment throw up for us. Peace is
kindness.
Peace is generosity. It is right and it is a duty. Romero was a deeply spiritual man with a rich prayer life from which he drew his strength. His lifestyle was simple and austere. His example to us is the beautiful, and there one is say the seamless synthesis he made in living and witnessing to faith and promoting social justice. He was neither a political activist, disguised in Episcopal robes, nor an opportunistic priest peddling a populist social justice project. Instruments of God. We can read together. Beautiful is the moment in which we understand
that we are no more than an instrument of God. We live only as long as God wants us to live, and we can only do as much as God makes us able to do. We are only as subject as God has to us.
He became a generator of communion and solidarity. He was utterly orthodox and utterly radical. He truly loved God and he truly loved his neighbor, the poor. He loved God in the poor, to the point of martyrdom. Oscar Romero is an icon of the option for